Welcome to worship on this sixth Sunday in the season of Easter. As always, we are grateful for your support of the ministry here at Swamp Lutheran Church. We invite you to continue to send in your offerings either to the church office or using our online giving portal found on our church's website. You may also want to participate in a worship service on Ascension Day. The Cocalico Area Lutheran Churches are going to sponsor a worship service on Thursday, May the 13th at 7 o'clock. The service will be held outdoors, so if you plan to attend, please bring your lawn chairs. The service will be held weather permitting. If the weather is inclement, the service will be canceled. We begin our worship today singing our first hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. The love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you joys beyond understanding. Pour into our hearts such love for you that, loving you above all things, we may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The first reading is from the 10th chapter of the book of Acts. While Peter shares the good news of Jesus with a Galilean Gentile soldier and his family, the Holy Spirit comes upon them. Recognizing that the Spirit works inclusively in the lives of both Jews and Gentiles, Peter commands that these Gentiles also be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. The lesson reads, while Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they invited him to stay for several days. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the second reading is from the fifth chapter of 1 John. God's children believe that Jesus is the Messiah and love God by keeping God's commandments. Thus the world is conquered, not through military might, but through love and faith. The epistle reads, "Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the parent loves the child. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we obey his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome, for whatever is born of God conquers the world. And this is the victory that conquers the world, our faith. Who is it that conquers the world but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not with the water only, but with the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one that testifies, for the Spirit is the truth." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On the night of his arrest, Jesus delivers a final testimony to his disciples to help them in the days ahead. Here, he repeats the most important of all his commands, that they love one another. Jesus said, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I choose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace to you, my sisters and brothers, in the Lord Jesus. Amen. You did not choose me, but I choose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Right here, in these words of Jesus heard today in our gospel reading, rings the very heart of the good news. This is pure grace. Grace is the gift brought to you by a friend, totally unexpected, overwhelming, and heartwarming. The sudden and serendipitous encounter with a stunningly beautiful sunrise or sunset, leaving you breathless and in awe of such sheer majesty. The first time a child smiles at you because she recognizes your voice and it gladdens her heart. Gifts which humble us and leave us joyful and thankful to be alive. I chose you, Jesus says. Choosing us, even knowing who we are. When we grow angry with those closest to us, our immediate family or friends, because they disappoint us, their failures and their shortcomings looming large in our lives, and we're unable to see in ourselves these same qualities that we so quickly ascribe to others. I chose you, Jesus says, in spite of, because of. Jesus chooses us because he loves us lavishly, abundantly, like a host who invites you to dinner, and when you arrive, you realize that you are the guest of honor. Or like a father who patiently waits for his wayward son to return. And when the son does return, the father throws the best party seen in these parts in a long time. That's how much Jesus loves us. But there's more. Jesus speaks these words to his closest friends, to those who trust him and follow him and listen to him teach, and who have sat there as he knelt in front of them and washed their feet in a basin of water and dried them with a towel. He will soon lay down his life on the cross out of love for the whole world. You see, that's what true love does. Love with a passion and a heart and a depth that is both gentle and fiercely strong, fearless and freeing. Such self-giving love often stands in sharp contrast with our modern world. Let me illustrate. Let's say you want to buy a new TV set. So you head over to the big box store, or more frequently today, you'll shop online, where you can pick and choose from dozens of different makes and models. You take it home, or it arrives by UPS or FedEx at your home, and you hook up your cable box or your internet streaming service. And now you have a choice of hundreds of different channels to watch. You see, the success of today's modern world centers on having choices, and lots of them. You go into a supermarket, and you don't want to just see one or two brands of chips or ketchup or cleansers. You want five or six, maybe a dozen. You see, Americans love choice. And love here is not too strong a word. Choice ranks extremely high on our list of values. The ability to choose what we want and when we want it, it drives our economy, it drives our politics, it drives every arena of our lives. We want to choose our own doctors, choose our own life partners, choose our own careers, choose those who we associate with, and what groups we join. And the list goes on and on. And at the heart of choice stands the autonomous self, free, independent, obligated to no one but yourself. A true self-giving love contrasts sharply with yourself as the center of your world. True love reaches in and creates a relationship which honors and respects and nurtures the freedom of the other person. We believe we've made the choice to love, but in reality, we're already loved so much by God. Our love of God in return isn't really a choice, but a response deep from the heart. Like that sunset you see, and you can't help but stand in awe. Or that totally unexpected gift from a friend. Our choice to love Jesus comes from the freedom that we've already been given as a gift of his love. Because his love respects and honors our humanity and dignifies us. Love born in freedom, and because of freedom, is not a chore. It does not weigh us down with heavy obligations. For the love of God is this, that we obey his commandments, John says in the reading we heard today. And his commandments are not burdensome. Jesus commands us to love one another, but this is not a burdensome command. Rather, it's a command born in freedom. For by first loving us, We are given our human dignity and our respect by God. We are lifted from the status of servant and slave, serving a God before whom we might have trembled and cowered. And now we're elevated to the status of friend. I do not call you servants any longer, Jesus says, but I call you friends. I remember seeing one of those church signs that you sometimes see outside of church buildings on a bulletin board. And this sign said, God loves you whether you like it or not. I understood the sentiment, and I think it was trying to say in an awkward kind of way that God loves us no matter what our response may be. We may love God in return, but that doesn't make God's love for us any deeper or more profound. We may ignore God's love, or we may take it for granted, or we might even reject it outright. But God will still love us and welcome us into our true home, like that father welcoming his returning son. I know this saying does have a kind of aggressive tone to it, and that's really not in keeping with the kind of love that respects and nurtures our human freedom and our dignity. Genuine love is concerned with how the recipient receives love. Just as Jesus is concerned with how we receive his love for us, he wants us to flourish and grow in our lives and among each other. He already loves us with a depth so great that he willingly laid down his life on our behalf. And in his rising from the grave, love is revealed as the goal and the fulfillment for everyone in the world. The Father loves the Son also with a passion and depth that he raised him from the dead. The Son lives, and that means that love will triumph for the whole world. All the world's anger, all our warfare, all our selfish choices we make with ourselves at the center, all the ways that we humans sow hatred among ourselves will dissolve away as the Son's life of love fills every human heart and life. We, his followers, are those who both model his love, begin to fill the world with his love, and to bear the fruit of his love. The fruit we are appointed to bear is the fruit of love. For love that is rooted deeply in Jesus is a love that will last and spread and grow so that one day all people will find themselves living in the true freedom to love one another. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Alive in the risen Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Loving God, you call us to be your fruit-bearing church. Strengthen the bonds among all Christian churches. Bless the ministries of all who share the good news of Jesus' love to all the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creating God, the earth praises you. The seas roar and the hills sing for joy. Fill the earth with your love so that by their song, all creatures of land and sea and sky may call us to join with them in praise. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Faithful Savior, you conquer the world not with weapons, but with undying love. Plant your word in the hearts of the nation's leaders and give them your spirit, so that the peoples of the world may live in peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Caring Healer, You forget no one and accompany the lonely. Be present with those who are sick or suffering. Provide for those needing homes or medical care, and point us towards life-changing responses to those needs in our own communities. Be with all for whom death draws near. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, as a mother comforts her child, you comfort us. Bless mothers and mothering people in our lives. Comfort those who miss their mothers, mothers who grieve, those who grieve because they cannot be mothers, those who have never known a loving mother. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gentle Redeemer, all who die in you abide in your presence forever. We especially thank you for those who shared your love throughout their lives, especially Tim Laura. Keep us united with them in your lasting love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And let us pray together. Our Father
in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come,
your will be done, on earth as in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us.
Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. We sing our final hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.